I'm not standing behind the podium because I'm so short that you will not see me, so I feel very uncomfortable when I stand behind podiums. So I made sure that they wired me up. I wanted to start with the acknowledgements on the country, because before this session, someone asked me what I was taking as an inspiration from Australia. And I didn't mention this, but for me it was very interesting to, that you acknowledge all the time, and I had someone print this for me. So I would like to start by acknowledging the Aboriginal owners of the land on which we meet today. Let's see if I can do better at Aboriginal language than our, my presenter here at Basque. Wurundjeri Boy Wuru and Wurruwong Bong Wurrung, people of the Eastern Kulin, and to pay respects and why do I to their elders, past, present, and emergent. And why do I do that is because I come from a colonialistic nation, and I wish that you know, what we did was as present in and acknowledged by everyone in every single start of the meeting. I also come from the Basque region, and you'll know more later. There is a region that had a tough transition in really acknowledging how we became Spain and how violent it was in the past and everything. So we're not nearly as outspoken as our contradiction. And also I come from a cooperative movement. And that means that while acknowledgement is the first step, I believe that you will be also part of the solution that comes after acknowledgement. So I wanted to put that there. And I have no idea how this is going to work, but I wanted you to know first where I come from. So, I wanted you to know where I come from, because a lot of people say Mondragon, and it's like a status when you're talking about the cooperative movement. When you talk about surfers, a lot of, any surfers in the room, surfing people, they know my region because it's a great surfing spot. If you're fans of cuisine, we have the pride of having the most amount of Michelin stars in the world per capita. And if you know co-ops, it's the biggest cooperative corporation in the world. So we have a taste for everything. But I wanted you to know where I come from, because it's really far away, like well over 20 hours of flight. And I came specifically to be with you today, so I wanted you to know that Mondragon, can we, next? There you are. And I wanted you to know what is Mondragon. Mondragon, for those of you who don't know, and although it was mentioned yesterday, it's one of the biggest cooperative corporation in the world. It's home to 95 different cooperatives, 85,000 plus people. And this is 2021 figures, so I wanted you to look at them because one of the things that we've been listening sometimes during these speeches that I've been hearing the last 5 days is that sometimes we confuse purpose with profit. And in Mondragon, we're very profit-oriented. People love to cooperate, but also they like to make profit, and the difference is what we do with that profit, right? So that is what the cooperatives are different on. And I wanted you to see this because in sales, Mondragon makes well over 11,000 million, and then they also invest well over 389 million, so I think that it will be nice to understand that the thing that they do different is not make money, but what they do with the money afterwards. So also I want you to know a little bit of the history, right? So I wanted to take you down the history line and understand that cooperatives were strongest, or they were born in the times of difficulty. You know the history of Rochdale, probably better than me. I will take you to the history of Mondragon. Mondragon was a small valley, very poor, after a civil war with a dictator. Remember, we were nationalistic, so we fought for the Republican side, so we were not very liked by Franco, right? Longest standing dictator in the history of Europe, so that's worse than Mussolini. And so when the founder came to Mondragon, he found people that were not very hopeful, were not very skilled, and didn't really know what they knew they needed for inspiration, but also people that had fought in different places of the war, and that they were needing to start reconstructing their space for living and look at the future with bravery and with inspiration. So I wanted to share with you a little bit of one very nice story that I like to tell when I talk about Mondragon. And I only found it out a couple of months ago when I was visiting some cooperatives for an interview process that we were doing. For you to understand how difficult it was to be a part of Mondragon, and especially if you were a woman like me, when you were married, when you were not married, you were part of the worker force and you can be a member of Mondragon. Back to 1969, okay? Dictatorship. So women could work and be members of Mondragon, and then when you got married, you got kicked out of the corporation. Suddenly, you could not do anything without the permission of your husband. You could not take had a bank account, you could not work, no financial autonomy for you. So a couple of people came to the priest and said, well, we want to change this. You know, like, I want to be a woman and I want to be independent. And how can we sort this out? Because you are, we are helping other people, and how can we help women? And these were a couple of women, but not together. Like, one by one approached the priest and said, like, what are we doing? And he came and said, well, let's gather you up, 17 women. And they created Ausolan. Ausolan was the first worker-owned cooperative of Mondragon, fully owned by women. 17 brave people that came together to defy this status. And this is why I like to say that cooperatives emerge when people, small people, come together to defy the status that they are living on and to create hope for the rest. Today, Ausolan is 13,000 people big, 95% women. And in the management, there are 5 out of 7 directors that are female. So they did a good job, right? They kept the hope going, and they are actually developing also a foundation that is helping other co-ops emerge in the sector of food and cleaning. So it was sectors that they could be part of the female workforce back in the day. And how does this happen? And yes, it is important to acknowledge that back in the day in Mondragon, maybe the figure that envisioned all of this was one person. And normally we give credit to the father Arizmendi Arrieta. I will not make you repeat that. Arizmendi Arrieta, it's our founder. And normally we give him a lot of the credit for what happened in Mondragon and what is happening still today. But you know what is? And I like that there was someone making the same similarity as me now before. He was probably the first team coach, right? He was a priest. He never owned anything in Mondragon. He was just there to support and make people do. And so to have a charismatic leader that is able to make teams develop is what I think is happening in this room today. You are all leaders here, right? So your mission, in a way, is to be the Arizmendi Arrietas of your time, is to actually make the people in your companies as inspired that by the time that they retire, the segment of cooperatives has grown. And I will tell you another anecdote of Mondragon. There were Ormaechea and Gorroñagoitia, 2 of the 5 founders of Mondragon, one day leaving the factory. And they said, do you imagine that when we retired, our company is running full speed, 80 employments? When they retired, there were 85,000. They couldn't believe, no? It wasn't possible to try to envision that at some point they were going to make that happen. But they were courageous enough to actually go to Germany and buy a patent of a gas oven to start a cooperative, a worker-owned cooperative in a very bad region of Spain in a dictatorship situation. So it just takes one courageous step by a group of people supported by a great leader to make things happen and change the world, right? And then this takes me to think how the cooperative movement is probably the most or naturally multi-generational movement that we can think of. Back in the day and today. Worker-owned cooperatives imply that most of the workers are members, and that everyone participates the same way in companies. That means that the newcomers, the younger people normally, are equally as important as the people that have been there for a long time. So this implies multi-generationality. Is that a word in English? Well, how many in this room, and that is going to be very rude. Let's see. How many people in this room are under 35? And that is what consider youth. Yes, okay. So there's two people, right? And one of them is the staff. So this tells you, you know, like, it is great to have inspirational leaders that are over 35. Let's put it there. Over 35 people are great people. But when we're trying to build a future and we want to tell the young people, this is your movement too, but I'll build it up for you, is not a great second part of the sentence we can tell them, right? It's like, how do we make sure that the people that are involved in our everyday life and make our cooperative as much as we do are also involved in these kind of inspirational spaces? Because they want to talk about it, they want to hear about it, and also is the best competitive strategy. Because you come here, you talk, you need to go back and tell them again. If you bring them with you, you save so much time, right? So at least one person that knows what's going on. But to take you back towards time, I think one of the main things that Arif Mendiarrieta said, though, did was educate people. Because cooperative members don't just happen, right? How many of you have met someone, a kid, like maybe 7, 8, and asked them, hey, what do you want to do when you grow up? Like, it's a normal question, no? You ask your nephews and your sons, like, what do you want to be when you grow up? And how many of you have heard someone say, I want to be cooperator? Not even in Mondragon. Like, Mondragon doesn't have those kind of kids either. You know, they want to be engineers. But I think it is important that, to understand that it is not the same to educate cooperatively than to educate about co-ops, right? And it's important to understand that when we educate in a cooperative manner, people become more cooperative in their everyday life. And I will give you a little fact also. In Mondragon, there is more employment than inhabitants. So they import people every day to go to the factories. And a lot of the good things happen, but Ander Echeverria, that is one of the divulgation managers of Mondragon, always tells me, Mondragon is not only one of the wealthiest regions in Spain, or where the index of inequality is the lowest. It's also one of the regions that divides trash the best in Spain, so recycles. And he asked me, do you think it's by chance? Or do you think that people have it in their mind and in their behavior to be responsible and participatory? We don't have any studies that prove that cooperators make better recyclers, but he keeps trying to make that point every time, right? And I know, and I want to show you an example of how you make cooperators, because cooperators and cooperative entrepreneurs are not born, are made. And this is a good news, you know, because if not, we would be in a bad situation. I wanted to be an engineer. In the Basque Country, 80% of the population goes to university, more or less, 80%. And out of that 80%, around 80% goes to engineering, because tool machinery, you know, this is the strength. And I wanted to do that, of course. I wanted to be transatlantic captain, you know, marine. I wanted to be there. And yet, at some point, Mondragon University came to talk to me about a degree where you learned to be a cooperator and were able to make your own company by doing. And maybe, and that was Traveling University. It's a university that educates cooperators without educating about co-ops. A lot of our graduates, they don't know a lot about the history of cooperatives. Probably they cannot bookkeep as well as any firm in the administration and finance department, but they create businesses, and they create by doing. And this is where I came from. And in Mondragon, we believe, and in Mondragon, and experience shows us that the best cooperators are not made by studying, are made by practicing cooperatives. And I think you could agree that the moment that you become a better participatory member, the moment that you become more aware of what it is to be a cooperator, the moment you become more aware of what is sharing, participation, common discussion, participatory management, and also in results is when you suddenly are part of a company that does that. And then maybe you miss it when you were in a company that didn't do it. But for that, you need to teach people, because Ariz Mendiarrieta said something that was very interesting, that is, to democratize power, we need to socialize knowledge. Because unless we made educated people, people are not going to be able to take educated choices. And this is a powerful statement, and it was back in the 60s, and it's today. When we want to create participatory environments and make our young people participate in our structure, or want our adult people to participate in our structure, and we want people to take ownership of their decisions and stop complaining to the outside world, but be consequent of what they do, the best way to do it is by educating and changing the way we think. And that doesn't happen overnight. In Mondragon, we don't have some genome of cooperators and Homo sapiens sapiens cooperatives. We had a priest that educated from 10 years before they started the first call. But who has 10 years to educate today? Do any of us think of educating for 10 years and then let's see what happens? We don't educate for 10 minutes, forget 10 years, you know? And we expect results. So I think the only way that we can do that is by inspiring people to do it today. And I go back to my notes because, you know, I want to make a point. And do you know when you are in an argument and you're arguing with someone and suddenly the best possible argument for you happens 30 minutes after when you're taking a shower? And you said, I would have won that argument if I were only this smart back in the day. I was talking with Melina the other day, and I was also reading very unpolitely when we were before a speech, and I came across one very interesting case of doing good, doing well to do good, right? So, and in the morning talk in the panel, and I took notes, someone said, we have the mandate from our users to have a positive impact, and that attracts them. But ultimately, people stay, but we need to understand that ultimately, while people want to have a positive impact by being part of a co-op, ultimately they stay because our products are excellent. And this is something that we need to understand, right? While we can be cooperatives and we can have a mission to do good, unless our products are great, they're not going to stay. They are going to go somewhere else because at the end of the day, people are smart, right? And this takes me to the other day when I was reading about Patagonia. All of you know Patagonia? Not the Argentinian South, the brand. Yes. And it's been in the news, eh? Because they sold to the earth. Patagonia has a very clear mission now. It's, we are in business to save the planet, right? And this means that they are coherent in the materials they use to produce their products. But to have these good materials, they need to raise their prices. But people still buy from them. Why? Because they make them feel that it's part of their mission. And the fact that they are paying a little bit more makes them feel that they are contributing as well. And this is a little bit like co-ops, right? Co-ops, we're not very good marketers. I don't know, maybe in Australia you are super good, but in the rest of the world, not so good. We're not very good at showing how great we are. We're just good. When we are leaders of the world, we don't tell, oh, we're leaders on the world on social change. We say we're leader on the world of this little part of the automation that you are using in your car. And we forget the business, the social model, right? So I think that it's good to remind the people that we do good also. I am going to finish, I promise. I wanted to remind you of, can I have my dance all the way down? Yes, amazing. I have a challenge for you. It's a good challenge, eh? It's easy challenge for all of you. I think for, and it takes me back to the conversation of under 35s. For all the few over 35s in the room, the challenge is we need to give people space. If we expect new people and new voices to join the conversation, we need to give those new people space. And we need to be courageous of welcoming those opinions and realize that the pie doesn't finish if we bring more people and we get a smaller piece. We get as much of a piece, but someone else gets it too. And the pie grows of the more people we come. So my advice or my challenge for you is bring one more chair to the table. Or even stand up from your chair and lend it to someone else. This would be amazing, but we are not going to push it that far, OK? And for the under 35s, that it's not so many, one is camera person and the other one's in the back, there is one even bigger challenge, that is, we need to take those opportunities, right? Because it is not easy to find a young person that wants to lead. Sometimes we are cohibited, sometimes we're shy, sometimes we are unsure, especially if we're women, we don't feel ready. But I think that is our mission, to not only put a chair on the table, but actually allow people to sit in. And as under 35s, we need to sit on that chair and, you know, put our hands up and take all the opportunities. Maybe it's not for you. Maybe it's not your space, and you just take it for a year and then pass it on to someone else. Because you know what is the worst argument? We tried it once, and it didn't work. And so to give that possibility of an argument to someone that is trying to put a new chair in the table against their will is a battle that is lost. So I hope to bring you three messages today before I leave. One is, there is a space for envisioning together. We can envision together. Two, we can visibilize each other's work and each other's power. And the third one is, we grab the opportunity. But most of all, we make opportunities to be grabbed. Because as one Australian colleague of mine used to say, we are not only here to break the ceilings, but to raise the floors. Thank you so much.